Hi, my name is Ken Boda. I'm an applications engineer with the dissolution group.
And my name is Brian Christ, and I'm a scientific affairs manager with Agilent. Today we're going to talk to you a little bit about filter validation.
So filter validation is a really simple technique to do that's often overlooked in a lot of dissolution method development and method validation. So filter validation is something you can really do in about 15 or 20 minutes. And filter validation really takes about three different steps that are part of it. So one is checking the filter's efficiency. This is just simply checking, is the filter removing all the undissolved drug and other materials that are in your sample? So we need to check that the filter removes all that particulate matter so that you don't get falsely high results. The second step is checking the leachability of the filter. This is just basically making sure that nothing is eluting out of the filter itself, which can interfere with your sample's absorption when you're reading it by UV or HPLC. The final step is checking for the adsorption of the filter, making sure that you don't have any significant amount of your dissolved drug being retained or stuck on the filter, so that's not getting in your sample and being read properly, causing a potentially biased low result. So Brian and I will go through each of these three steps, and hopefully we'll get a good filter validation out of that.
And I just want to mention a couple other things. The filter validation is actually something that's done very early in method development. We're going to use it for many studies through development to look at the stability of analytical solutions, as well as Ken talked about, the three points on stopping the dissolution test and, of course, not causing interference in the sample. The second thing is that the standards themselves are very often checked at the wrong concentration. You know, for samples to be checked appropriately on how much they bind to the filter, we generally use samples that are in the lowest concentration. For instance, if your first time point is going to be around the 20% mark of your dissolution profile, that's the standard we really want to evaluate to determine the most efficient filter to use. So with that, we're just going to show you some exercises.
So for efficiency, we're going to take a sample very early on in the dissolution profile. So we'll pull our sample. And then we'll dispense into three different aliquots in three different test tubes. Try to get these a little bit even. So we'll take it over here to the sonicator. And we have these labeled out as 0, 5, and 10. So what's meant by that is the 0-minute one, I'm going to immediately analyze by UV. So we're not going to give the sample a chance to undergo any additional dissolution at all. So this is going to be our control for the experiment. The other two are the 5 and 10 minute samples. So these we're going to put in a sonicator in this case, but you could use a shaker or some other device, or even manually shake it with the stopper. And we're just trying to make sure that if we have this undergo additional time and abuse, that we don't see an increase in the percent dissolved value, which would indicate that our filter was letting drugs slip by and could lead to much higher biased results and also more variable results. So just simply turn this off, and after 5 minutes, pull the full first sample, read it on UV immediately, wait another 5 minutes, and do the same with the 10-minute sample. So efficiency, we're really looking to make sure that we've removed the undissolved drug from the solution. So usually we're taking a fairly early time point in the dissolution process, taking a sample and splitting into the three aliquots that I showed earlier. So an example of a bad filter efficiency can be shown in this chart. So you would see something like the blue curve for our unmixed or unsonicated sample that's been pulled. And so we have an absorbance that is at a, let's call this one absorbance unit. Our next sample, let's say we've abused it, let it sonicate for 5 minutes, something like that. We see an increase in the absorbance to maybe 1.1. Again, further abusing the sample, 10 minutes, let's say, we can go up to absorbance of about 1.2. So this is exactly what we don't want to see, because as we agitate that sample and as time passes, we're seeing that our absorbance is going up because more and more drug is being dissolved in that solution. So ideally, when we perform an efficiency study, we should see three curves that are essentially superimposed on one another, with the absorbance not really differing more than 1% between the three samples relative to the absolute standard. So in the case of taking a sample at about 25% dissolved, you'd want to see something that maybe would be 25, 25, and 26% dissolved. That's something where we would say this is a validated and acceptable for use filter.
To wrap up with filter absorption studies, what we're going to do is take a nominal concentration of a standard down around the 20 to 25% range. Again, this is usually around the first time point. What we're going to do is to evaluate the absorption effects of the filter binding the drug substance. And to do that, we're going to fill a syringe with 10 milliliters of the solution I just described at about 20%. I'm going to attach a filter, and what we plan to do is to add 1 milliliter to each of these HPLC vials consecutively. The goal here is to determine how much volume we need to waste through the filter before it doesn't bind any more drug substance. So this is to achieve with any method the amount of filter that we, the sample that we need to waste.
I want to speak a few moments about adsorption. Filter absorption is one of the primary reasons when we use a membrane filter that we have to evaluate that we're maintaining the integrity of the sample. This is especially true at, as I said a moment ago, low concentrations. Low concentrations we can see where it may take quite a few milliliters before the filter itself is saturated with drug product. For instance, as an example, you might see here a standard made at, let's just say, 100% of label claim. If we push a sample through a filter, we should see within the first milliliter that comes out through this filter a fairly low recovery. And eventually, that recovery gets much better as that filter is no longer binding drug substance. But hopefully where this point can be more evident is where we do have low concentration samples in the 20% range. And you can see for what may have taken only 4 or 5 milliliters of 100% concentration may actually take well over 10 milliliters at a concentration down around 20% dissolved.
So another test that we need to do with filter validation is doing a leachability study. This usually applies more towards syringe filters, such as this disc filter you see here. And basically we're looking to make sure that our filter itself isn't putting any chemicals or things into the sample by pushing the solution through that's going to cause an interference in the reading of your main peak of interest. So this chart here, you can see it's very simple. We have red representing what our standard mixture would be, a blue line at the baseline indicating what the media is, that media composition including any surfactants, buffers, anything else that may be in that mix. And then we have a filtered media. So blue would be unfiltered of your media. The green line here is indicating that I've pulled that same media through the filter. In this case, you can see that there's a little peak that has appeared. Now, if we're looking at our area of absorbance and our wavelength of interest and carry that down, we can see that the little green peak has an absorbance in the same area as does our standard of interest. So in this case, we would need to evaluate how significant this peak is. Generally, you're looking to have your any blank peak that's created by a filter or anything else being less than 1% of the absorbance of your standard concentration. So in this case, if we're following this graphically, this obviously looks a lot more significant than 1%. If you do see one of these peaks come out, it doesn't necessarily mean you can't use this filter. You may need to do a rinse through of that filter with some blank media or discard a certain amount of your media before you put it into your sample. But generally speaking, you'd want to select a different filter. It's important to note that the absorbance of the, the maximum wavelength of your contaminant peak or whatever's eluting off the filter may not be the same as your API of interest. But if there is any sort of mixing whatsoever, that's something that we need to avoid to ensure that we have a proper sample and we have an accurate result of what's actually in that solution.